Okay, so welcome back to this next video in which we are discussing angiogenesis and angiotherapy. Okay, right, so we're currently in the process of discussing hypoxia-induced angiogenesis. Okay, so we've discussed that when a portion of tissue becomes hypoxic, it's going to start sending out cries for help. Okay, and one of the key cries for help that this hypoxic tissue releases is the vascular endothelial growth factor A, which is often just called the vascular endothelial growth factor. It's not the only cry for help that a hypoxic area will release. It will also release the vascular endothelial growth factor C and vascular endothelial growth factor D, but they're less important. And we'll also see later on that there's another one also that's released, which is fibroblast growth factor 2, which is quite important. Okay, but we'll come on to that later on. For now, let's just concentrate on vascular endothelial growth factor A and how a hypoxic cell actually starts expressing vascular endothelial growth factor A. So this pathway is actually very well understood. Okay, so I want to discuss this in some detail. Okay, so basically, these cells that are experiencing hypoxia are going to start expressing vascular endothelial growth factor A. Okay, they're going to start producing vascular endothelial growth factor A proteins, whereas previously they were not producing those proteins. Okay, so basically, somehow the hypoxia needs to induce a epigenetic change. It needs to change which genes are actually going to be expressed. So remember, epigenetics is a field in molecular biology which is all about the control of which genes in the genome are actually going to be expressed. Okay, so usually under normoxic conditions, cells do not express the vascular endothelial growth factor A to any large extent. Okay, but now under this hypoxic condition, they're going to start hugely upregulating their expression of vascular endothelial growth factor A. Okay, and I want to discuss how that is actually done. Okay, right. So, firstly, let's just talk a little bit about basic epigenetics, okay? So, let me draw two parallel lines here to represent a piece of double-stranded DNA. Okay? And let's colour in a portion of this double-stranded DNA, this portion here in blue, and this portion can represent the vascular endothelial growth factor A gene. Okay? So, this is the VEGFA gene. Okay, now, upstream of the vascular endothelial growth factor A gene, and indeed upstream of all eukaryotic genes in the eukaryotic genome, there will be a region called the promoter region. Okay, and although the promoter region is not actually involved in being translated into protein, okay, it's very important for controlling the transcription of the downstream gene. Okay, so this portion in red is going to represent the promoter region. So basically, the promoter region is the area where the RNA polymerase 2 enzyme, which is the enzyme which will actually work its way along the coding strand of the vascular endothelial growth factor A gene to produce a piece of mRNA, it docks onto the DNA, it binds onto the DNA at this promoter region. Okay, but it's not the first thing that binds to the promoter region. Firstly, what binds is a bunch of general transcription factors, okay, and then on top of the general transcription factors, the RNA polymerase 2 binds. Okay, so in order to discuss this, we need to discuss what general transcription factors are, and before we can discuss what general transcription factors are, we need to know what a transcription factor full stop is. Okay, so let's start with what a transcription factor is. So basically, a transcription factor is a molecule, it's a protein, which has the capability to bind to DNA. Okay, and it will have a specific sequence of organic bases in the DNA that it will recognize and be able to bind to. Okay, so it will have a certain sequence of DNA, let's call that a DNA sequence, which it's capable, whoops, I've missed off the A. DNA sequence, which it's capable of binding to, basically. And generally, these DNA sequences are between 4 and 10 base pairs in size. Okay, so between 4 and 10 BP. So basically, all the transcription factor is a protein molecule that's capable of binding to a certain DNA sequence, okay? And it will bind to that DNA sequence wherever that DNA sequence is found in the genome, basically. Okay, right. Now, transcription factors are incredibly important in regulating the expression of genes, and they can be divided into two major categories, okay? There is the general transcription factors, okay, which are involved in the transcription of every single gene in the genome. Okay, now there are very few general transcription factors, okay, and these are the ones which bind to DNA sequences that are found in the promoter region, and they need to bind there in order for the RNA polymerase 2 to dock on top. Okay, so let me just draw these on the picture. Okay, so maybe here is a general transcription factor binding to the DNA. Here's another one. Okay, now a key example of a general transcription factor, and there are a lot of these. Okay, a tiny number compared to the other class of transcription factors that I'm about to mention, which is the specific transcription factors. Okay, but there's still more than you'd care to memorize. Okay, I think there's something like 30 or 40, close to 40 of these things. Okay, and they bind to specific sequences that are in the promoter regions upstream of every single gene, and they are essential to, it's essential that they bind to the promoter region so that the RNA polymerase 2 can dock on top of them, and therefore dock on top of the promoter region. Okay, so I was in the middle of giving you an example of a really important general transcription factor. Okay, so the really important one that generally people can remember the name of is transcription factor 2D. Okay, so TF is for transcription factor, okay, and then Roman numeral 2 and then D. So transcription factor 2D, usually just abbreviated down to TF2D, like so. Okay, now, this binds to a very specific sequence of four organic bases that is found in the promoter region of every single gene. Okay, and that's a very famous sequence of organic bases. That's what's known as the Tartar box. Okay, so because the sequence of four organic bases is thymine, adenine, thymine, adenine. Okay, so basically, if we say this one is transcription factor 2D there, it will be binding to a Tartar sequence in the promoter region there. Okay, so that one can be representing transcription factor 2D. So I've drawn two general transcription factors on my picture here. In reality, there's much more than that, okay? But it is a number lower than 40. I think it's actually 31 specifically that you have within the human cell, okay? And their role is to bind to sequences that are found in all promoter regions, and then what assembles on top of them is then the RNA polymerase 2, okay? So here is RNA polymerase 2, which for short we'll abbreviate down to RNA for RNA, P for polymerase, and then 2. So RNAP2 we'll abbreviate this down to. And basically, what will happen then, if you want to actually transcribe your downstream gene, is you need the general transcription factors to bind onto the promoter region, then you need the RNA polymerase 2 to dock on top of there, and that's not trivial. RNA polymerase 2 is not a single protein, it's a multi-protein complex, it's a massive, great complex of proteins. Okay, so that entire thing needs to dock on top of there and assemble, okay, and then it can work its way along the coding strand of the gene. Okay, so let's say this one on the top here is the coding strand, okay, and it will now work its way along this coding strand and synthesize a piece of mRNA that is complementary to that coding strand. So here's the mRNA. Okay, right. So the general transcription factors are absolutely essential for the transcription of all genes in the human genome. If you don't have them, then you can't get your RNA polymerase 2 docking at the promoter regions, and therefore you can't make any proteins at all. Okay, now, there is another category of transcription factors, which is the one that we're going to be more interested in. I mean, obviously these are extremely important, okay, but they're the same for every single gene, they're just part of the transcription machinery. The transcription factors which are more famous than the general transcription factors because they're generally more involved in pathways that people know. are the specific transcription factors. And often when people just talk about transcription factors, usually they mean specific transcription factors rather than general transcription factors. Okay, so these are the ones which combined again to certain sequences of DNA, and they will only bind to sequences of DNA that are found only in front of certain genes. So the sequences of organic bases that they bind to will be found only in front of certain genes, okay? So they're only going to affect the transcription of certain genes, and they can either promote it or repress it. Okay, now, specific transcription factors also have another name that you might hear used for them, which is to call them transcription regulators. Okay, and I might occasionally use that name for them. Okay, right, so what are these molecules? Well, basically, they don't bind to DNA sequences that are found in the promoter region. Instead, they bind to regions, sequences that are found in the region prior to the promoter region. So a wider portion of DNA that's prior to the actual gene here is what's known as the gene control region. Okay, so the promoter region is just part of this larger portion of DNA upstream of a gene called the gene control region. Okay, and these specific transcription factors are going to bind to sequences of organic bases that will be found in this portion of the gene control region that is upstream of the promoter region. Okay, so I'll reiterate this. The gene control region is this huge portion upstream of the gene. Okay, and all genes in the eukaryotic genome have a gene control region. Part of the gene control region, the portion that's right upstream of the gene, is what's known as the promoter region, and that's the place where the general transcription factors bind, and the RNA polymerase II then docks on top of them, and it can then go and actually transcribe the coding strand of the gene. However, there is this other portion of the gene control region, which is the portion of the gene control region further upstream than the promoter region, basically, this portion that I've coloured in yellow here. And this is the place that you're going to find the DNA sequences for specific transcription factors to bind to. Okay, so let me show this here. So you might have a specific one of these DNA sequences for a specific transcription factor. Okay, and it will now bind on top of there. Okay, and basically, the DNA binding sequence for a certain transcription regulator will not be found in this region for all genes. Okay, it will only be found in this yellow region upstream of certain genes, and that's why these are called specific transcription factors, because they only affect the transcription of certain genes, whereas the general transcription factors affect the transcription of all genes. Okay, right. So, here is our specific transcription factor here, binding to a certain DNA sequence that is found in this region of the gene control region upstream of the promoter region. Okay, now, what do these specific transcription factors do then? Well, basically, they can either promote the transcription of the downstream gene, or they can repress the transcription of the downstream gene. Okay, and transcription regulators which increase the transcription of the downstream gene, they are known as activators or enhancers. Okay, and the transcription regulators which decrease the expression of the downstream gene, they are known as repressors. Okay, right. Now, how can these transcription regulators binding to these DNA sequences in this portion of the gene control region upstream of the promoter region actually affect the transcription of the downstream gene? Well, there are multiple ways. Some of them will actually affect the assembly of the RNA polymerase II complex directly. Okay, so because of DNA looping, this will be able to loop back. You know, in three-dimensional space, this could actually be very close to the promoter region because the DNA could loop back on itself, okay? And the transcription regulator could influence the assembly of the RNA polymerase II complex. And if it's an activator doing this, it will increase the probability that the RNA polymerase II complex will assemble on that promoter region. If it's a repressor, it will decrease the probability that the RNA polymerase II will assemble on that promoter region. Okay, so some transcription regulators will influence directly the probability that the RNA polymerase 2 is going to assemble on a certain promoter region. Alternatively, many transcription regulators work by changing the structure of the chromatin locally to this gene. Okay, so let me just explain this. So DNA is not just free in the nucleus, instead it's in a structure known as chromatin, which basically means the DNA wound around histone proteins. So let me just draw you a little picture of what chromatin looks like. So basically, here's the DNA, drawn as a line here. And then what's going to happen is it wraps around histone complexes, okay? And these are complexes of many, many proteins, okay? So this is a histone complex here, represented just as a square here. And basically, the DNA will loop around the histone complex twice. So I'll draw this. So there it's looped around once, then it will loop around again, and then it will go off. Okay, and now what can happen is it can loop around another histone complex. So I'll draw another histone complex here. It will loop once around it, it will loop twice around it, and then it can go off up here. And then, of course, you can have another histone complex here, and you can get this beautiful repeating pattern, basically, like so. And this is how cells store their DNA. The DNA is wrapped around these histone complexes, which I'll colour in vivid purple here. Okay, right. Now, the DNA can be wrapped around the histone complexes at different levels of tightness, basically. Now, if DNA is wrapped around a histone complex extremely tightly, then it's not possible for the general transcription factors to bind to promoter regions that are in this region of DNA that's wrapped around the histone complex. And it's not possible for the RNA polymerase 2, therefore, to assemble on top of those general transcription factors. So basically, what I'm trying to say is if your promoter region for your gene is in a portion of DNA that's wrapped around a histone complex, which it's very likely to be, because very little fraction of the DNA is actually in these linker portions between the histone complexes. Most of the DNA is wrapped around a histone. Okay, so if it's wrapped around too tightly, then you can't actually get the RNA polymerase 2 assembling on that promoter region, and therefore you can't express the downstream gene. Okay, so chromatin structure hugely affects which genes can be actually transcribed, basically. And because only those genes where the promoter region is freely available for the general transcription factors to bind, and therefore for RNA polymerase 2 to bind, only those are actually going to be expressed, basically. Okay, so often the way that specific transcription factors or transcription regulators, whatever you want to call them, work is by changing the structure of the chromatin locally. Now, how can you do this? Well, basically what you can do is if you want to activate gene expression, what you want to do is make the DNA wrap around the histone complex more loosely. Okay, now the way that you can make the DNA wrap around the histone complex more loosely is by acetylating the histone complex, okay? So adding acetyl groups onto the proteins of the histone complex. So acetylation means the addition of acetyl groups, the acyl group corresponding to acetic acid, which is just a 2-carbon fully saturated carboxylic acid. Okay, and enzymes which add acetyl groups onto histone proteins are known as histone acetyl transferase enzymes, and for short, those are abbreviated to HAT enzymes. Okay, so if a transcription regulator wants to activate gene expression, one of the common ways for it to do that will be for it to act as a docking site for a histone acetyl transferase enzyme. So basically, a histone acetyl transferase will come and bind on top of the transcription regulator, and then it will start acetylating all of the histone proteins nearby, and that will loosen up the DNA locally, and therefore, hopefully, you'll loosen up the portion of DNA in which this promoter region's in, and therefore increase the expression of the downstream gene. Okay, so that's one of the ways that transcription regulators that are activators can work. Now, if you're going to be a transcription regulator that's going to be a repressor, then you're going to do the exact opposite thing. You're going to make the DNA more tightly wound around the histone complex. Okay, now how can you do that? Well, you can add, instead of acetyl groups, you can add methyl groups onto the histone proteins. Okay, and the process of adding methyl groups onto proteins is known as methylation, or in fact, the process of adding methyl groups onto anything is known as methylation. Okay, and the enzymes which put methyl groups onto histone proteins are called histone methyl transferases, okay, or for short, an HMT. And I've had the same problem again. Histone methyl transferase, which is HMT. Okay, so if you are a transcription regulator that's a repressor, then you could bind one of these histone methyl transferase enzymes. This could then methylate the histones in the local area, cause the DNA to now wrap around histone complexes more tightly, and therefore reduce the transcription of any genes in that local DNA. Okay, and therefore reduce the transcription of your downstream gene. Okay, right. So those are the key ways that transcription regulators, or these specific transcription factors, can alter the gene expression of many, many genes. So I'll stress this again. Specific transcription factors have a specific sequence of organic bases which they recognize and bind to. Okay, and this sequence will be found in the portion of the gene control region upstream of the promoter region for a huge number of different genes. Okay, but not all the genes, not like the general transcription factors. You know, this goes up to like hundreds of genes, not all 30,000 genes of the human genome. Okay, so it'll be a few hundred genes maybe. Okay, and it will then affect the transcription of the downstream gene. It will either increase the probability that the downstream gene will be transcribed, or it will decrease the probability that the downstream gene will be transcribed, either through directly influencing the assembly of the RNA polymerase 2 on the promoter region by interacting with it directly, or by remodeling the chromatin. Okay, as I say, they can either activate or repress the assembly of the general transcription factors and the RNA polymerase 2 complex on the promoter region. Another thing to note is that it's not necessarily the case that a certain transcription regulator will be an activator at absolutely every single gene that it binds to the gene control region of. It might activate some, it might repress others, okay? So it varies depending on which gene that you're specifically looking at. Okay, so basically, the way that we are going to increase the expression of vascular endothelial growth factor A proteins is through a transcription regulator that is going to bind to this portion of the gene control region upstream of the promoter region of the vascular endothelial growth factor A gene, and is going to enhance the transcription of the downstream gene, i.e. it's going to be an activator. Okay, and we'll continue this discussion in the next video where we'll see that specific transcription regulator that's involved in doing that.